Your daughter, I understand, actually inspired you to write this book. What did she say that sparked you to action?
Well, this all started 15 years ago after we watched Al Gore's movie. You remember, An Inconvenient Truth. Well, Mary Doerr was an inconvenient youth because at dinner that evening, we went around and said, how do people react to it? Mary said to me, Dad, I'm scared and I'm angry. Your generation created this problem. You better fix it. And I was speechless. The room went silent. Honestly, I didn't know what to do. And so partners of mine and I decided to learn more about the climate crisis. And as you know, we traveled the world, visited labs. We went to the Amazon, to China. We started investing. And over the course of three funds, invested $1 billion in some 70 or so ventures. Many of them failed. It was really hard. And in fact, some gave up, said we should give up. We stood by those entrepreneurs, and today their shares are worth some $3 billion. But more than the money, companies like Beyond Meat or QuantumScape have really set a course to drive others to take action in meat without meatless proteins and better batteries, as an example. But what I know now is it's very clear. We're on the verge of a catastrophic and irreversible climate crisis, and so we've got to act. And more than anything else, what we need is a plan.
Okay. Let's talk about that plan, because you have one. Everyone talking about reaching net zero by 2050. How are we going to do it?
Well, it turns out there's six big buckets of opportunity to reduce 59 gigatons of emissions to net zero by 2050 or sooner. And those six simply are to electrify our transportation, clean up our grid with solar and wind, to fix our food systems, to protect nature, and then to clean up the industrial processes like cement and manufacturing. With those five, we can remove 49 of the 59 gigatons of emissions. And there's a sixth category where we clean up the stubborn remaining carbon. For each of those big objectives, Emily, we have a handful of key results, OKR style, the way Google or Andy Grove would do them. And this whole plan, it's available for free. It's on the website speedandscale.com. So you can download it, print it out, and get some sense of the magnitude of the transformation that we've got to go through to pull this off.
Now, you came to clean tech many years before many other venture capitalists, and as you said, many companies failed. At this point, do you still feel like you have something to prove there?
Oh, I think we have something to prove every day, all the time. But the climate, no pun intended, has really shifted in that regard. When we started, there was maybe $2 or $3 billion per year of venture capital invested in clean tech. This year, the estimates are it'll be 10 times that amount, say some $30 billion. Larry Fink, the CEO of BlackRock, he said he thinks there'll be 1,000 unicorns in climate tech. So the investor sentiment has changed, both for venture and also for institutional investors. There's an institutional investor alliance of some $150 trillion of portfolio capital that said they want to see their dollars aligned with net zero enterprises. So this, the corporate sector, the investing sector, the entrepreneurial sector, they're all leading the rest of the world. It's our governments and political leaders that are reflecting public opinion and lagging.
So you spoke to many business leaders, including Larry Fink, as you mentioned, Bill Gates, Sundar Pichai, Jeff Bezos. I want to talk a little bit more about Jeff Bezos and Amazon, given their climate footprint. How can they be more a part of the solution?
Well, they're a major part of the solution already. They've pledged that their operations, their supply chain, will be net zero by 2040. That's 10 years ahead of the Paris goal. And then they've reached out to other businesses to sign them up for the climate pledge, is what it's called. easily as impressive to me is that Jeff Bezos has committed $10 billion to climate philanthropy. And that makes him the largest climate philanthropist in the world. So look, everywhere we turn, we need more ambition and more urgency. But Amazon's helping to set the pace.
What about Google? Google's also made some pretty bold targets.
Google was very early in matching all of its electricity usage with the purchase of renewables. They've done the boldest thing of all, and that's to say they intend by 2030 to have all of their energy needs directly supplied by renewables. So no offsets, no greenwashing. They're going to use solar, thermal, geothermal energy so that every Google query you ask about can be powered with renewable energy. They're also building a wide range of tools for municipalities to do planning of their transit systems, and for even individuals now on Google Maps to choose the most climate-friendly path to get something done.
So what are your big takeaways from COP26? You know, are you seeing more business as usual, and is enough really being done at a global level?
Well, when Greta Thunberg says COP26 is a lot of blah, 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 she has a point. The point is pledges are fine. What we really need is action and follow through. I'm very impressed by what the COP conference agreed to do around methane emissions. It's important that COP is not over yet. Just today, the US and China did something really worth noting, and they issued a memorandum of cooperation, which identified five areas in which the US and China are going to cooperate beyond what's in the current pledges and agreements. So I think the current plans do not get us far enough, but they should make us hopeful.
Hopefully there will be less blah, 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 as you say. Now, I have to ask you, you have seen so many cycles of innovation in Silicon Valley. What do you think is going to define venture capital investing and tech growth for the next decade of post-pandemic Silicon Valley?
Well, I believe there are huge tsunamis, as I think you know, the first of which was the microchip in the PC, the second of which was the internet, the third of which was mobile and cloud at about the same time. We've entered the fourth wave, and my belief is that it is the combination of the pervasive reach of AI technologies and the economic imperative of the climate crisis. I think climate will be the largest economic opportunity of the 21st century, and technology will play a really important role.